Hi, and welcome back to another lesson in the Modern Physics video series. Today, we will be discussing the Standard Model of Particle Physics. The Standard Model of Particle Physics is the theory describing three of the four known fundamental forces. These are the electromagnetic, the weak, and the strong interactions, and not including the gravitational force, that are present in the universe, as well as classifying all known elementary particles. We will be looking in detail at the classification of matter chart that's found here on the reference table, as well as the particles of the standard model. We will then take a look at each one of these particles. We will see that the quarks combine to form fundamental particles, such as the proton featured here as an up, up, down. We'll also take a look at the neutron, as well as how a proton and neutron can exchange types. In this next slide, we're going to take a look at the classification of matter chart in more detail. Matter is classified and broken down into two major groups, the hadron and the lepton. The lepton, as you see here in the particle model chart, contains electrons, muons, taus, electron neutrinos, and other kinds of neutrinos. The lepton is a particle that is not made above any other particle. So we're most familiar with the electron. The electron is a small charged mass. However, the hadron is in fact made up of other particles. The hadron is broken down into two categories, the meson and the baryon. These sound like they're fancy words, but they actually are only Greek-based words. Meson, like the word meso, meaning middle, and baryon, which is really from the Greek varis, meaning heavy. A meson is a medium weight particle because it has two subparticles, a quark and an antiquark. And a baryon is a heavy particle because it has three subparticles, all of them are quarks. Here on the right side of the same slide, we have a list of six quarks: up, down, charm, strange, top, and bottom. The reason why these quarks have the names that they do, as was relayed to me by a physicist working in Brookhaven National Lab when speaking about the history of this subject, told me names were originally derived from the way the charged particle trail curved around in the supercollider when they looked at the plates and observed the trajectories of ejected particles. Some went to the top, some went to the bottom, some went up, some went down. But then others were discovered that had different patterns, which were very strange, and one made a particular shape that someone named it charming, or experimentally observed qualities, and someone had to name them. The standard model of particle physics explains the nature of the atom and states that atomic particles are composed of subnuclear particles, as we mentioned before. The nucleus is a conglomeration of quarks, which manifest themselves as protons and neutrons. We're going to explain how the neutron comes to exist and what its function is inside of the nucleus. Each elementary particle has a corresponding antiparticle. An antiparticle and a particle annihilate each other and turn back into light when they come into contact. Charge is quantized in two levels. At the atomic level, we're used to the elementary charge and the number of electrons in a valence shell giving an atom either a positive ionization, a negative ionization, or a neutral status. But there's also a subnuclear charge, and these are the fractional values of elementary charge called the quarks. These quarks have either 2/3 or negative 1/3 of the charge of an electron. This is very important because when we add them up later, we're going to see where we get a positive 1 elementary charge for a proton, a negative 1 elementary charge for an electron, and a 0 charge for a neutron. For an antiparticle, its mass and lifetime spin are identical but opposite in charge. And antimatter is a material consisting of atoms that are composed of antiprotons, antineutrons, and positrons, and a positron is a fancy word for an anti-electron. We're going to explain that in a little more detail coming up. As I mentioned earlier, a quark has a fractional value of an elementary charge and are found in combination with other quarks in larger particles of matter. The proton and the neutron consist of quarks. There are 6 known types of quarks: up, down, charm, strange, top, and bottom. And I mentioned a little anecdote about those before. The particulars of quarks. Ordinary matter, which is made of atoms that you would find on the periodic table, contains 2 lightest quarks, the up and the down. But cosmic rays, which are the next lightest, contain a charm and a strange. Heaviest quarks, top and bottom, which are not found in nature, are produced in a laboratory, as are many other kinds of radioactive materials which emit particles. Just as there are quarks, there are antimatter quarks. Quarks have antiparticle counterparts called antiquarks, and these are produced in the laboratory. An antiquark has many of the same properties as a quark and has some properties that are opposite. That's why it's anti. Anti is a Latin word meaning against or opposite. A top quark is massive, and a particle accelerator can generate this by smashing atoms together, and this is an ejectile particle. The particle accelerator is a machine that speeds up smaller particles and collides them with one another. When matter meets antimatter, they annihilate each other and they turn back into light. Hadrons. Hadrons are particles that are made up of many quarks. And as I mentioned earlier, there are 2 kinds of hadrons: the meson, the medium weight, and the baryon, the heavyweight. The baryon has 2 famous particles called the proton and the neutron, which I know you're familiar with. A proton is made up 2 up and 1 down quark, and a neutron is made of 1 up and 2 down quarks. We're going to add these up later, and we're going to see how the charge of a proton and a neutron come out to be positive 1 and 0, respectively. Okay, let's take a look at how a proton and a neutron are actually made. So a proton is classified as an up, up, and down. So you have 3 quarks. 3 quarks makes it a baryon. It's a heavy particle. And an up, up, and down are here on the reference table. An up has a positive 2/3 charge. Another up has another positive 2/3 of an electron's charge. And a down has a negative 1/3 of an electron. If you add that up, you get 2 plus 2 minus 1 is 3/3 of an electron, positive 1 charge. Now, a neutron is very similar. A neutron is defined as up, down, down. An up quark has a positive 2/3 of an electron, and each down is negative 1/3 of an electron's charge. When you add up negative 1/3 plus negative 1/3, which is negative 2/3, plus the 2/3, you get 0/3. You get 0 charge. And that's why a neutron is neutral and a proton is positive. A meson contains only a quark and an antiquark. Hadrons interact through strong nuclear forces. The strong nuclear force only acts within the radius of the atomic nucleus. It does not go beyond that. We're going to talk more about that in detail when we look at higher order nuclei. Here's a brief discussion on the meson. Mesons, which are medium weight particles composed of quark and antiquark, they are found while studying cosmic rays, and a cosmic ray is a high energy particle that originates in space. The pion. These are mesons that enter the atmosphere and consist of an up quark and a down quark. An up quark and a down quark have the opposite charges, and their total charge comes out to be 0. But a strong nuclear force binds quarks together. And finally, we're going to discuss the lepton. I did mention this earlier, that the lepton is the 3rd generation of the quark. It's a particle that interacts through electromagnetism, weak gravitational force, but not the nuclear force. The most famous one is the stable electron. The next most famous one is the anti-electron, which is given the fancy name of positron. It has the same mass as an electron, but it is the opposite charge. So an electron has a charge of negative 1. A positron, as its name implies, has a charge of positive 1. The muon and the tau are also leptons. The neutrino and the antineutrino have no charge, no mass, and they have energy and momentum. And all of these particles are ejected in radioactive disintegration. This is the energy that escapes when it is disintegrated or cracked open in an atom smasher during atomic collision. In conclusion, in this brief video, we will now summarize the fundamental forces in nature. There's the gravitational force, which everyone is familiar with, that acts as an attractive force between masses. Then there's the electromagnetic forces, which work on charged particles. We then began to discuss the strong nuclear force, which is what holds the nucleus together and only acts over the short distance of the nuclear radius. And then there's the weak nuclear force, which is the mechanism of interaction between subatomic particles that is responsible for the radioactive decay of those atoms. So those are the four forces in nature. We have looked at all the particles and the standard model which holds it all together. I hope you enjoyed this lesson and thank you for watching. We'll see you in the next video.